إذا ما مات ذو علم وتقوى فقد ظلمات من الإسلام ظلما.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق وسيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين سيدنا محمد عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. I'm very very happy to be here today with such a good crowd and our speaker Dr. Jasser. And today I'm just gonna walk you through what Horizon Academy is all.
I'm trying to present some new thoughts about the topic, and therefore we need youthful minds and even with gray hair, but we need useful minds to absorb that. I would like to thank Horizon, of course, for inviting me. This is such a good opportunity. Last time I visited Calgary was ages ago. So glad to be back. And the MSA, last time I participated with MSA here in an activity when I was in the MSA, that was about 20 years ago. So a new generation had come. Proud of them, and inshallah, I'm sure that they will do a better job than the job we did with the MSA in our time. I'm sure that they have a better grasp of the realities of this society and what it takes really to represent Islam and to work for Islam in this part of the world. So, Jazakumullah khair. Islamic jurisprudence, and I put jurisprudence between quotes, because I think the brothers and sisters meant in Arabic the word Sharia, or in English the word Islamic law, sometimes Islamic jurisprudence. But to me, Sharia is not Islamic law. Sharia is Islamic ethics. And I will explain, this is what the lecture is about. It doesn't mean that the Sharia has no impact on the law. Sharia could have an impact on the law if the legislation had taken, you know, parts of the Sharia to become parts of the law. But Sharia is not really equal to the law. And not everything in the Sharia is necessarily part of the law. And not every crime in the sin in the Sharia is necessarily a crime. When we talk about law in English, we mean in Arabic al-qanun. And when we say Islamic law or al-qanun al-islami, it really doesn't mean anything in Arabic for those who know Arabic. In Islam, in Arabic, you talk about Sharia, or you talk about fiqh, or you talk about qanun. And the qanun could be inspired from the Sharia and could have articles from fiqh, but it's not equal to, Sharia is not equal to qanun. Sharia is a much wider message than the legal message and has so many dimensions other than the legal dimension. And that is very important. And I think that the basic essence of the Sharia, that to me is very clear, is an ethical essence. And what do we mean by ethics? Do we mean what to do or what not to do on an individual level? What is haram to eat or halal to eat, and who to marry, etc.? Yes, it includes that, but the Islamic ethics is not only about my individual practice and individual actions. To me, Islamic ethics is about everything in life. And therefore, it is very important to talk about new Islamic ethics or new Islamic fiqh, if you wish. But in this case, fiqh will not only deal with the individual practice and the actions. Fiqh will deal with everything in life, because Islam is for everything in life. And Islam is for every space and every time. And therefore, when we talk about fiqh today, we're not supposed to be talking only about my individual actions and my little decisions on a personal level about my food and clothing and all of that. These are important. But beyond that, if I am a politician, how do I do politics from an Islamic perspective? If I am an economics guy, or if I would like to open a business, how can I open an Islamic business? How can I do Islamic art? How can I do Islamic media? How can I do Islamic management? And Islamic everything as you go. What we have so far is a very strange understanding of Islam that produces fiqh for these areas that is very inappropriate, to say the least, for today. So for example, when we do Islamic art or Islamic movies and all of that, I was in Thailand a few months ago, and the brother who took me from the airport, in the car, he said, "You have to watch our first halal movie in history." I said, "In history, the first halal movie." He said, "Yes, we have an Islamic movie now in Thailand." I told him, "Great, great, brother. Okay, what did you do for the movie to be halal?" He said, "First of all, we don't have any women in the movie." I said, "Okay." "Okay, so just a movie with men, that's halal?" He said, "No, something else. We don't have any music." I said, "Okay, so doof and all of that." He said, no. "If you hear the movie, it's exactly like music, but it's not a doof. And we are actually doing all the sounds with our mouths. We are making the sounds of the guitar and everything. And you wouldn't even feel the difference. But I swear, brother, there is no instruments there." I said, "Okay." "Okay, and what else?" He said, "The topics themselves." I said, "They deal with social issues, families, people growing up in whatever situation." He said, no. "The issues are all from the Sahaba time. And they're all hadith sahih, Nobody says anything that is not sahih. We went through all the scripts." And that's for him is an Islamic movie. He told me, though, I told him, "Do you have any audiences there?" He said, "We're sold out for the second month in a row now." So people are lining up, men and women, obviously, to see this whole male movie where the brothers, if they want to appear, as well, he told me, if they want to show a sister or a woman, they will put a hijab on the brother, but from the back, they take the camera to the back of the guy so he doesn't. A whole story. So, we with no offense, we do a lot of things like that. We do Islamic banking like that sometimes. We do Islamic food industry like that sometimes. Sometimes it's very superficial. It is not Islamic in the core. It is something that appears to be Islamic, but at the end, it does not stand on Islamic foundation. And that is what we need. We need a new movement of Islamic sciences that take the different sciences and the different disciplines and the different professions and approach them from an Islamic point of view. But that will require, some thinking. And how can we do that? The answer which inshallah I will talk about in this lecture has to do with maqasid al-sharia, has to do with the purposes, objectives, ends, the principles, if you wish, of the sharia. In this case, as I translated it, as ethics or as an Islamic way of life, rather than a law only. So this is not a legal approach only, in which we are trying to look at different issues from a legal sense, as if we are dealing in a court, but it has to do with approaching the different disciplines and the different areas of life and different things from an Islamic perspective. Now, if we're talking about fiqh and new fiqh, how did fiqh evolve? If we look at fiqh, how it evolved, and I will take a few minutes in this because I really want to leave a lot of space for this proposal of maqasid al-sharia and for a discussion. If we look at the map of the movements of the Sahaba, after the Prophet, They dispersed all over the place. Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, as many of you know, is buried in Istanbul. Some of the Sahaba are buried as far as, you know, today's India, etc., today's Africa, up there in close to Europe, etc. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum dispersed all over the place. And they took their fiqh with them. They took their understanding. Fiqh is understanding. They took their fiqh with them in different places. And from them and their disciples or students and the students of the students, we started to see madhab. We started to see Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Malik and Imam Shafi'i and so forth. And if you follow the chain of the students of the Sahaba and the Imams of the madhab, what we call now Imams of the madhab, you would see that they are quite interlinked. So many of the Sahaba, probably, I'll take you through some of the charts from one of my books, the Maqasid al-Sharia, the systems approach. If you look at the different companions, I chose five or six of them here, and then their students, and then their students all the way to the ones in blocks there who are the Imams of the Madahib that we consider Madahib today, you will see that their knowledge was mixed in the minds of these Imams. The Imams of the Madahib never intended on founding Madahib. This is not how it is. If you study properly, you will see that they were great people of their times. And then their students carried their legacies. Some of the great Imams of the time, Sufyan al-Thawri, al-Awza'i, and so on, had their usul and had their ways of looking at the Quran and Sunnah and had their narrations and so forth. But their students were not as good to their professors and their imams as Abu Yusuf, for example, was to Imam Abu Hanifa, or as the students of Imam Ahmad or his son had taken his legacy and went ahead with it, and so forth, Sahnoon, etc. So when you look at the madhahib, you really need to understand the madhahib in terms of the history of fiqh rather than fiqh. Because the madhahib have taken the Quran and Sunnah, which is the pure source of Islam. Islam is the Quran, and the Sunnah is an illustration of the Quran. وَنَزَّلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so that you illustrate to people. Prophet ﷺ was a Quran walking on earth, as Aisha said. So he was telling us, what does the Quran mean? The Quran says, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ, he shows us how to pray. The Quran says, give zakah, he shows us how to give zakah, ﷺ. Now, what happened afterwards is what we call in this knowledge, ijtihad, putting effort in order to find the right answer for the questions. Fuqaha, some of those made ijtihad that was widely accepted by many people, and they left a legacy. The students of their students, to cut a long story short, had decided to put what's called al-usul, or the principles, or the fundamental theory. So when you read, for example, al-Sarakhsi, one of the students of Abu Hanifa, when he wrote his book al-usul, in the introduction, he says that I'm writing this book in order for those who want to follow Abu Hanifa, to follow him in his methodology, in the way he thought, so that when you would like to follow him, you try to think like him so that people could follow the legacy properly. And this had happened, by the way, in over many imams over our history. Every imam until today have a number of teachers and sheikhs. Many of them said, well, don't follow my opinions, follow my methodology, follow the way I think, follow the philosophy I take, kind of thing. But you don't have to exactly follow my opinion, because the opinion could be right and could be wrong. Every imam of fiqh said, رأي صواب يحتمل الخطأ رأي غيري خطأ يحتمل الصواب. My opinion is right, but it could be wrong. And the other opinion is wrong, but it could be right. So these great people in our history had developed a legacy that their students carried after them and publicized, and the students of their students, in every madhab except for the Shafi'iyya, and if you know the history of Usul al-Fiqh, if you've taken that course, you would know that, except for the Imam al-Shafi'i. Yet, of course, if you go through the Shafi'i madhab, it was really Juwayni and al-Ghazali and so on who had more impact, I would say, on the Shafi'i. But in any case, this is history. Is it important? Yes, it is ultimately important. You cannot do fiqh today unless you understand the history of fiqh. So that when you study the history of fiqh, you know how to do fiqh today. I happen to be a member on a couple of majami' fiqhiyya. And when we give fatwa, we look at the reality of today. When we look back in the history of fiqh, especially for new issues, what we call al-nawazil, or al-masail al-jadida, the new questions. Transplantation, for example. You find some of the scholars, and Doctor, you would know that very well, some of the scholars, if they want to judge whether organ transplantation is correct or not, they insist on looking into the old madhah. And then they come up with a fatwa, oh, so-and-so allowed for you to have a golden tooth or a silver tooth, so-and-so had fixed so-and-so's nose by putting a golden nose or a metal nose, so yeah, transplantation is halal, kind of thing. But that, anybody who has any knowledge of medicine would say that this is exactly like that halal movie, because this is not considering the reality of that thing. There is a huge difference if you're going to transplant a finger or a kidney or a heart or a reproduction organ or something. These are very different things. And research tells us, and I'm not a specialist, but I have students who wrote theses on transplantation and so on, so I learned with them. Research tells us that when you transplant somebody's heart, this has an impact, or even a kidney, even on the psychology of that person. And it could be an impact that is very harmful to the person. So yes, when you transplanted that heart, if you look at the heart as a pump, and if you live in a different century, and think that the heart is exactly like a tooth, or the tip of the nose, then yes, you can remove a heart and put a heart, kind of thing. But if you're going to consider the heart with all of its dimensions, and all of the complexity of the science of today, then you really have to look further into the impact of what you are trying to achieve here. And the impact of that fatwa. And it's not only the medical / psychological, biological impact. There is also an economic side of it. I used to live in the Arabic Gulf, and I know that 100% of the donors are non-citizens, according to statistics in these countries. Which means that the donors are the migrant workers, really. Like in summary. And the receivers are the rich people of these oil-rich countries. This is an economic dimension of the fatwa that has to be taken into consideration. Now, people are selling their organs. Well, the fatwa said you cannot sell your organ, yes. But then the government said nobody is allowed to sell their organ. But when they give an organ, they can receive a hadiyah, you know, a gift. So that's, again, a hila, you know, a trick. Like the Thai movie, I will pick on it today quite a bit. That kind of hila doesn't like complicates the problem, and actually perpetuates a what they call organ transplantation tourism. Unfortunately, some poor countries in this world live on that, and you find the prices over the internet. You know, a kidney for $500 or whatever for $1,000. And that is an impact of a fiqh that did not live the reality of today, that did not look into medicine on a philosophical level and an ethical level, really. Why medicine? Is medicine in the medical profession a business that the rich can afford and the poor cannot afford? Or is it for the purpose, for the maqsad, for the objective of healing somebody? And that healing, on what cost am I going to heal somebody? If I'm going to give that person that operation, or I'm going to do, what kind of cost I'm paying? Not just the monetary cost, but the human cost, and the environmental cost, and the economic cost, and so forth. And the psychological harm and benefit. and so forth. And when we deal with an issue like that today, we have to look into the real fiqh, the real understanding, so that when we give a rule that this is halal or this is haram, of course, everything has to be halal or haram, or any action is either good or bad, and from an ethical perspective. But the question is how to judge. How to judge that? Is it ethical to do this or not? When we look at also another example, and at many of the transactions, well, what we are doing with most of the Islamic banking, let me say most of, so we're not offending anybody, inshallah. I know that some people are trying hard. What we are doing with most of the Islamic banking and the Islamic companies is capitalism, but with an Islamic interface, with an Islamic marketing tool. I heard a guy from HSBC, he said, well, this is a good marketing tool. People don't want interest, okay, that's fine. We take the interest, he told me. That's fine, we just invest their money and we take the interest. They don't want interest, we take it. Not mentioning any bank in particular, but basically, sometimes we are just putting an attire on a capitalist institution and a capitalist system to the core that is based on a capitalist philosophy that believes in the scarcity of resources. In the Quran, the resources are not scarce. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made earth abundant with khayr. I'm not, again, an economist, but I am raising questions of the basis of the system. A bank is the heart of a capitalist system. So we cannot just make it Islamic bank and put a hijab on it or abaya or something and then make it a bank just by calling it an Islamic name, putting Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and then instead of calling a certain contract a mortgage, we say, well, no, this is rent, and this is, no, it's either riba or not. So interest, then it's riba. This is, you know, by definition. Well, some fuqaha, I'm a member of the European Council for Fatwa, they allow this for the darura and so on. Once you get into the darura and the hiyal and so on, is that then you get into a kind of fiqh that is trying to struggle with the reality, but is not putting a basis for a new science. And therefore, at the end, you are doing capitalist economics. Just because the Islamic mind has an issue with Marxism and socialism and so on, because of the religious connotations that comes with communism, and Marx said that religion is the opium of people. So that had an influence, because back in the 50s and 60s, even as early as late as the 50s and 60s of the past century, you will find that many Muslim scholars had written on socialism in Islam and ishtirakiyya in Islam and all of that, and social justice in Islam and how Islam can bring a social justice system and so on. But then this, all of a sudden, by the end of the 80s and end of the century, had changed into an old capitalist system. So at the end, you're talking about a big market for Islamic financing, but it is, I would say, a parasite market on the capitalist market. It's not an independent market, and it is serving, and at the end, doing riba. Bottom line, it will do business with the stock market, or will do something that is not always considered murabaha in the sense of sharing the risk and all of that. At the end, there is a lot of this that is not correct from an Islamic point of view. When you look at the usul, and therefore we need to develop new ideas for usul based on maqasid, time would not allow me to give much detail, but when you look at the usul, you will find that the scholars agreed on the Quran and Sunnah in principle, and they differed over what I call in my writings tools for coming up with the ahkam. Whether you are talking about the ijma' or qiyas or istihsan or istashab or istaslah or sadd al-dara'a or istashab al-asl, etc. And all of these are tools, really, for those who understand the role of usul al-fiqh. They are tools. Al-ijma' is a tool of, if you wish, collective decision-making. How can we have a collective decision among the scholars. If you are talking about scholars, if you are talking about Ijma' al-Ummah, as Ibn Hazm had put it, Ijma' al-Ummah doesn't need Ijma' al-Ummah. Everybody knows that. وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَصَوْمُ رَمَضَانَ وَحِجُّ الْبَيْتِ. Nobody in the Ummah will come and say that, no, we don't do Hajj in Mecca, we do it somewhere else, or we fast January and not Ramadan. Nobody. That's Ijma' al-Ummah, if you really want to talk about that. If you're talking about Ijma' of scholars, you find, I wrote that in a couple of these books, I found 62 different definitions of Ijma', so which says that there is no Ijma' over the definition of Ijma'. There is no consensus over the very definition of consensus. I'm not saying that consensus is nothing. No, it is very important. It's a tool, though. It's a tool for collective decision making. When I attend the Majma' Fiqhi and we try to come up with a fatwa, we vote, we talk and try to get each other out of the other opinions, etc. Somebody brings a presentation with another consideration that we have to look at, and then we come up with a collective decision. So basically, it is a matter of collective decision. But when you say ajma' ulama' al-ummah over something that is different, differences in opinion, Ibn Hazm in his early life wrote a book that in his early years called Maratib al-Ijma', the levels of Ijma'. And then Ibn Taymiyyah wrote a critique of that, Naqdu Maratib al-Ijma', in which Ibn Taymiyyah, almost every opinion that Ibn Hazm said is a matter of Ijma', Ibn Taymiyyah said, no, this is not a matter of Ijma', so and so said, so and so, so. And all of them are respected scholars and everybody. So when you deal with usul al-fiqh, let's agree that usul al-fiqh are very important, but they are tools rather than ends in their own right. They are ways of reading the Quran and Sunnah into the rules for today, into the halal and haram and the ahkam and so on for today. But when you study these usul closely, you will see that they deal with one dimension of science, and not every dimension. What I mean by that, when you look at a siyasa sha'iyya, for example, or the Islamic political theory, when you look at a siyasa sha'iyya, the Islamic political theory, and you look at the different chapters of that, you will see that a siyasa sha'iyya is dealing with a state that is not today's state. If you really talk about siyasa as in governance, it's dealing with a khilafah. And yes, Muslims have to form a political unity, etc. If you ask about my opinion, I think that the nation states are good tools for governance, but they are not ends in their own right. And I do believe in a pan-Islamic state, etc., or a union or a federation or some sort of a union amongst Muslims that unites them. And I'm aware of all the minorities issues, etc. But what I'm saying is, there is no fiqh for the nation state for today. Fiqh al-siyasa al-shar'iyya, when you read it and you have a political science background, this is not talking about the institutions of the state. It doesn't tell you how to make policy. It doesn't tell you how to distribute wealth and how to answer the basic questions of economics. And so forth, what to produce and what to consume and who and what and how and why. It doesn't answer this. It is talking about Bayt al-Mal or the public trust in the past, and then tells you who gets what shares and how the zakah is collected and how the jizya is collected, etc. It's talking about a different world. And when you deal with today's policy making, even more specific than politics, if you take policy making as in governance, and institutions and laws that are made with a purpose to change people's behavior in order to achieve certain objectives. How do you take this from a siyasa sha'iyya? It doesn't give you much. One of the chapters under siyasa sha'iyya called the fiqh al-idari, or the fiqh of management. But when you read this, this has nothing to do with today's management and the questions and the issues of leadership and issues of organizations and culture and so forth. When you look at how management developed, oh, thank you, it's so kind of. When you look at how management developed in other sciences, with other philosophies, this is all good. But they didn't refer to the Islamic background. And it could be very useful to take a leadership course with an American leadership expert, etc. But with all what the Quran is talking about in terms of leadership, we don't have, or we have, but not very well known, different places, different universities. Sometimes I come across some discoveries of some people who worked a lot about this. We don't have a standard textbook leadership in Islam that deals with leadership in a systematic way as we deal with leadership today when you take that course with the American guy. There are areas that are absent from today's fiqh, or rather the history of fiqh that we refer to. When we deal with arts, and you look in history, arts shapes people's lives, and especially when arts take the form of entertainment, when a novel comes out in a movie, or a painting comes out in a game or something, that becomes very different arts. Now, how do you deal with that? When you go back to the history of fiqh, you see that there is a chapter that deals with what's called a sama', or hearing music, listening to music. Whether you can listen to music or not, and the differences of opinion is well known. When you deal with that, there is no mention of arts. This is not arts. There is some talk in the history of fiqh about shi'r, about poetry, etc., and what Allah is allowed and what is not allowed. But we cannot tackle with this literature the questions of arts for today. And again, when we approach arts in an Islamic way, and we want to come up with a song or whatever, then what we have to do is to bring a duf. Why? Because, there are hadith in Bukhari and Muslim that have the duf, and so bring the duf, and we stick to that. Or we do qiyas, analogy between a duf and a tabla, a drum, and then we use the drum. An electronic drum, maybe, fine, sure, it's still called a drum. And then we go by the names, really. But we don't really look at the basic questions. Why arts? Is arts any expression? Does any expression count for art? If we're asking from an Islamic perspective, then no, not any expression counts for good arts. Well, artists ask you this question. Can art be good or bad? Like, is there a value embedded in art or not? This is a question we have to answer. I haven't seen answers for this question. And we are not taking these approaches in order to answer the questions that are basic. Is arts for art's sake or arts for a purpose? Is there a teleology for an end for the art? Now, when we approach that, and then if we define the end in art according to the ends we have in the Sharia, or Maqasid al-Sharia. So when you deal with Maqasid al-Sharia, you deal with the necessities and needs and luxuries, and I'm sorry, this talk is not an introduction to Maqasid al-Sharia, so you can read about that. Al-Darurat wal-Hajiyat wal-Tahsiniyat. Necessities would be حفظ الدين والنفس والعقل والمال, the preservation of faith and mind and intellect and wealth, etc. And then there is a needs, the level of needs like trade and transportation, etc., and the level of luxuries that have to do with beautifications and جماليات والتحسينيات, etc. Or we are talking about الخاص والعام and so forth, the general maqasid such as justice and mercy and common good, العدل والرحمة والمصلحة, ابن القيم ونيساد الشريعة عدل كلها ورحمة كلها ومصلحة كلها, etc. Or you're talking about those who went straight to the Quran and came up with maqasid based on an understanding like al-huquq and so forth, and al-tazkiyah wal-imran wal-tawheed and so on. And all of these what they call kulliyat, or the universal values. So this approach is an approach that asks why. And when we ask why the Sharia, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send this message with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ مِنْ الْأَمْرِ الشَّرِيعَةِ, we go to Maqasid al-Sharia. And Maqasid al-Sharia are the answers of why that could answer the questions of why in economics and arts and management and politics and so on. So when we talk about why politics, it is not about the interest of the few. كي لا يكون دولة بين الأغنياء منكم. الله سبحانه وتعالى mentioned in the Quran that the some of the rich are not supposed to just circulate the money. You can understand it as a prohibition of monopoly, not just for the wealth, monopoly also for the power. So one of this maqasid, one of the principles, one of the values in Islam and in the Quranic view is to share power. When people don't share power, they become pharaonic. Pharaon said, مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى وَمَا أَهْدِيكُمْ إِلَّا سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. I only show you what I see and I only guide you to the right path. This kind of pharaonic thinking is the kind of politics that some people preach today in the name of Islam. So they quote in Mawardi, for example, when he said لِلْحَاكِمِ أَنْ يَسْتَبِدَّ بِالْأَمْرِ the governor could basically decide on his own. And that shura, that the Quran is talking about as a higher value in Islam, is just mu'lima, it's just information. So I make shura, and then whatever you say, I go the opposite direction. Because this is not mulzima, this is mu'lima. And then they go and quote some hadith in some way, or you know what Abu Bakr Umar radiallahu anhuma did with Hurub al-Ridda or something. Like whatever evidence. And then they cancel a principle of the Quran. So that kind of renewal requires going back to the Quran to look at the principles of everything. Does the Quran have principles for everything? Yes, it does. But it depends on how you read it. If I am a doctor and I read into the Quran about the human nature and about the human welfare and then I will start to have some ideas in my mind based on what the Quran is telling me about the human. Because who could talk about the human better than the creator of the human, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if I'm an economist and I open the Quran, I promise you that you will see so many economic things here and there in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us guidance about how to deal with today. But the Quran did not specify a certain time or a certain place because the Quran is for every place and time. What we did, unfortunately, we froze the Quran to the time of the 7th century or at best the 12th century. And then we stopped there. We stopped at al-Ghazali with the Shafi'iyya or the others, contemporaries at Ibn Taymiyyah with the Hanabila and so forth. Because we didn't go beyond the history and the historical understandings of the Quran and try to go back to the Quran and look at values for today in different sciences. So what we need to do is to put the basic questions of sciences in front of us, including sciences of legislation, I would venture to say, and then go back to the Quran and find answers for all of these questions. Legislation, I'm talking about the public level. I'm not talking about the ibadat and the individual actions. These are fixed and these are immutable. We will never change, not just ibadat, to be more accurate, at-ta'abudiyat. At-ta'abudiyat is the fixed part of Islam that have to do with rituals. In the mu'amalat or the ibadat, you see, it's not just ibadat. There are many things in the family law that are ta'budiyat. There are things we follow because they are specified clearly in the script, al-qat'iyat. I'm not talking about these. I'm talking about everyday-to-day science and everyday-to-day knowledge that we borrow from others and we build institutions sometimes as Muslims based on that. And then we fail to serve the ummah and we fail to serve the values of Islam. So we end up with an economy that serves capitalism or arts that serves, you know, culture or some cultural branch of arts or an approach to politics that serves a certain agenda that does not really represent the values of Islam when it comes to leadership and politics and so forth. So in the time that I'm allowed, I gave this as some thoughts about the issue of Islamic jurisprudence and renewing it. And I'm hoping that the discussion, inshallah, will bring some more questions and so forth. I prefer to give those for the questions too, because I have a lot to say. I have a lot to say, but I prefer, inshallah, to answer questions. I'm As I mentioned, I really appreciate the average age, the low average age that we have today, which is really a very good sign. And I don't think that any of this talk, even though some of it is a bit academic, is above our younger brothers and sisters here. We want them to think about these things, read about these things. When we were your age, I mean, we read, you know, philosophy and so on. We didn't understand half of, Plato's Republic or whatever, but we read, we tried to. And then eventually you start to comprehend the big issues and so forth. So I really appreciate your presence today and the invitations. Jazakallah khair. As-salamu alaykum.
If you have a question, feel free to ask the question in Arabic or English. If you ask it in Arabic, I'll translate it. And if you ask it in English, I'll repeat it, inshallah. So, any questions?
As-salamu alaykum. What we find in the Western world is that, also in our world back home, governance of people is probably one of the most important aspects that we need to figure out. And first of all, has there any systems? I appreciate that you mentioned Shura in the Quran, but it's not really practiced. Has any work been done that we can learn from on how to govern ourselves in the West for our communities?
Well, the West developed mechanisms for decision making on a collective level that I think are very useful, and I think we need to make use of them in our communities. We're talking about our communities, so we're talking about organizations and mosques and so on. I think we should use the systems that are developed, for example, voting as a mechanism for decision making. But we should, so democracy in other words, but I think we should avoid the drawbacks of democracy. Many of the drawbacks of democracy are ethical drawbacks. You know, when people are not really rigging the votes, but they are rigging who votes, or they're playing with the rules, or they make the voting in the night when nobody comes, this kind of, you know, playing by the rules, playing in the rules. It happens a lot in Islamic organizations, everywhere. And it is a problem. I think we could do democracy for the logistics of decision-making and collective decision-making, but we have to deal with it with integrity and ethics, like really. Why democracy? Why do people in the West invented democracy? They tried to come up with a collective decision-making mechanism. How can, of course, this is part of the system, the part that we really need. How can we make a collective decision-making for all members of a mosque? How can we make a decision? And they came up with these mechanisms. And of course, there are a number of ways of doing voting, a number of versions of democracy anyway. So our best bet is to use a democratic practice, but to be ethical about it. Now, we also have to apply the Islamic values of Shura, for example. Prophet ﷺ did Shura and didn't play with the results, ﷺ. Like he did not think that going out in Uhud was a good idea. And he was right, eventually, we now know. But he decided to take the Shura of his companions. So we have to go out, they went out. And then in other times, they were right. They proved to be right. So the Shura as a concept, we need to start to devise institutions for Shura and mechanisms for Shura. How can we do Shura in a way that is ethical and sincere and so forth? How can we manage these organizations? Now, when we think about an organization, we have to look at the purposes or the ends or the mission, vision and mission and this kind of thing. So when we do a strategy like a vision and mission and values and so forth, we need to look at them with Islamic eyes. What kind of mission can we have that really serves Islam? And let's look at the bigger picture of Muslims. And let us try to be sincere in the mission we put and the activities we do, etc. So we try to look at the issue with sincerity and integrity. When we deal with countries, this is a very different story. Because when we deal with countries from an Islamic perspective, we have to be very careful not to fall in international agendas. You know, at the end, you find an Islamic agenda or an agenda that's claiming to be Islamic in some monarchies or whatever. And then they are an integral part of a bigger international political game. And that is not Islamic. And that lacks leadership and courage from some of our leaders in the Muslim majority countries to basically say that we are going to form something based on Islam and not shy from it or apologize for it. It doesn't work to apologize. The world will eat you, as we say in Arabic, if you try to be weak and apologize. And if we're not up to it, then we focus on civil society and we theorize for the civil work and the civil engagement so far, until we are strong enough to have true Islamic leadership and Islamic government. Not a government that looks Islamic and not nice names and so on, or people dress like, you know, like this, whatever, without mentioning any names. People dress Islamic and appear Islamic. And they borrow, you know, the turban from Anthony Quinn in his movie, The Message. And they want to pose to be an Islamic solution for anything. And you look at them, oh, this is not Islamic. This is a disaster. If you understand the political situation, and you see that some of the people who claim to have Islamic roles in terms of their governments are serving colonization, as clear as that, and are just simple spies on us as Muslims and Asians, and betray the Ummah in the name of Islam, and they find somebody to give them fatwa. That's easy, but at the end, this is very problematic. So when we approach countries in the name of Islam, we have to be courageous and we have to put forward economics and politics and so forth that are Islamic and seriously Islamic. So.
Any other questions? Yeah.
Assalamu alaikum. Thank you so much, Dr. I really appreciate your time. And I know if we are giving you 3 hours, perhaps I'll be able to get more answers to some of my questions. So I will prioritize my question because I've visited 6 years, but I can't take 6. So the first one is not a question. Can you please go back to your first slide, please?
Okay.
I just want to understand the role of Aisha in the evolution of the fiqh, because I saw Aisha Ali and I saw Huma. So the first one you showed, yes, this one.
Uh-huh.
So I want to see the connection of Aisha. Yeah, I can understand the Ali with Ali Hussein, and I can see understand Ibn Abbas. So when you are talking about the evolution of the thinking of the Matai, so what role did the Aisha play actually? No, it's not one of my 6, but I can take it.
Aisha, the mother of the believers of Allah anha, played a very important role in a number of ways. One of them is through these companions. These companions, if you look at the people who narrated after Aisha the most, you will see Ata and Ibn Musayyib and Nafi' and Salim and Urwa and Ubaidullah and so forth. You'll see Fuqaha al-Madina, what they called Fuqaha al-Madina afterwards. They narrated after Aisha radiallahu anha, and they learned from her. So a part of the wealth of the hadith that is narrated after the Prophet ﷺ is narrated after Aisha. Aisha radiallahu anha also corrected some narrations that were against the general sense of the Quran or what she knows about the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. There is Suyuti, for example, he collected some of these in Al-Ijaba or Al-Isaba. Al-Ijaba, فِيمَا اسْتَدْرَكَتْهُ عَائِشَةُ عَلَى الصَّحَابِ. The right answer of what Aisha amended in the companions' narrations. Aisha radhiyallahu anha amended a number of narrations that she realized are contrary to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, as she knows them. Did the companion make errors? Yes, I mean, Aisha corrected them. There is no way of putting them together. If you go back to Suyuti's book, you will find some 70, 80 examples of Aisha correcting some of the companion's narrations. It's not black and white. A companion could make a mistake in one of the narrations. Hadith al-Tayara, for example, when Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu narrated that al-Tayara or bad omen, al-Tayara tu fil marqati wa dabbati wa dar. A bad omen is in your woman, your mount, and your house. And they went and told Aisha that Abu Huraira made this narration. And she said, مَا كَانَ الْحَدِيثُ عَلَى هَذَا. The Prophet did not say that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then she mentioned two narrations, one of them, that كَانَ أَهْلُ جَاهِلِيَّةِ يَقُولُونَ الطِّيَرَةُ فِي الْمَرْأَةِ وَالدَّابَّةِ وَالدَّارِ. People of the days of ignorance used to say that. And then Abu Huraira entered the mosque in the middle of the hadith. So he narrated the second half of the hadith, for example. So I find, and I wrote a particular paper on this, it's on my website, published, on Aisha radiallahu anha and her amendments, istidrakat Aisha, and the importance of that in what's called naqdul matn, or the critique of the content. You see, the narration, when it's sahih, it is sahih according to the chain of narration. But there's another degree of sahih, degree of authenticity, which is the soundness of the content. Aisha radiallahu anha contributed a lot in this area. Aisha radhiyallahu anha was involved in the political life of that time, and she sided with Muawiyah, etc. And the story is well known. But that's politics. The companions radhiyallahu anhum had different views when it came to politics. Could it be right? Could it be wrong? Yes. I mean, there is nothing wrong in a companion radhiyallahu anhum making a wrong political decision. You know, this is human. They are not prophets. They are not infallible. So if you want to critique some of the decisions she made in her political decisions later, you could. But that's different from her contribution to the knowledge. The students of Aisha radhiyallahu anhum were, from a general analysis, were more oriented to look at the Quran when they critique the narrations of the hadith. And it doesn't mean, again, it's not black and white. This stuff is from a book. Before that, I wrote a whole chapter on what's called multidimensional logic. A logic that's not black and white, that's not a binary logic, that is necessary for a contemporary usul al-fiqh. Cannot really say this is just either right all the way or wrong all the way. Everything that the companion narrated is correct all the way or not all the way. That doesn't go like that. Like that kind of logic is not possible. After putting all the madhahib and all the wealth of hadith together that we have today, there are so many muta'arad, so many internal differences or contradictions, and we cannot resolve them with a binary logic. So that's the kind of answer.
Any other questions? I'll take a question from the sister and come back to you.
Assalamu alaikum. I have a question about women's role in government. You know, growing up, I heard that, you know, time and again, that women shouldn't be in positions of power because they're emotional, they can't rule properly. But I mean, myself and many other women in this community have been pushing to be in leadership roles. I mean, just last week, four Muslim women were named to the top 30 under 30 in Alberta. So my question is, what does the Quran and Hadith say about women in government, whether it's right or wrong?
Be careful, she's my daughter.
Question.
Now the difficult question. Talk about fiqh, let's talk about women. It's What is the reference? What is the reference when we talk about Islam? The reference is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the reference. When we go back to the hadith, we will see that the women around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were in the masjid 5 times a day. They fought with him in wars. They traded, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself married one of them, Khadija radiallahu anha. They took leadership positions as much as their capacity had allowed in every way of leadership. And this is a longer story, it's a separate lecture, I would say. So there is, I mean, when women fight with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, imagine that you go and fight in the army with the Prophet. This is a lot of danger and a lot of, and we, I mean, some people don't allow women to drive cars today, not just, you know, take a leadership position. This is politics, and it's bad politics. Especially in the area of women, there is a lot of problems that was caused by the rift, the political rift between the Najdis and the Hijazis in Arabia. I know this is very foreign to you guys, but this is how I see it anyway. And that rift, since the Najdis are now in power, had caused them to align with opinions that are politically better for a fragile system. And therefore, you will find a lot of fatwa and billions of dollars spent to publicize these fatwa for the sake of monopoly over oil resources. So when we go back to the Prophet Sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you don't see any restrictions on women. The restrictions are moral restrictions, and on men too. You know, as long as men behave, they are fine. As long as women behave, and there are differences between men and women when it comes to the awrah, when it comes to some issues in the family law. Just because mothers, you know, carry babies and so on, and therefore they have differences in the law, in the fiqh, more precisely, and the law as well, when it comes to law, in terms of custody, in terms of the rights, in terms of men's responsibility in the family, etc. There is a difference, natural difference, between men and women when it comes to awrah and so on, and therefore women cover different parts from men. The ahkam, there are ahkam that are different for many natural reasons. But what you are talking about, there is no difference between men and women. Women could be anything. They could be judges, they could be, because people who rejected for women to be judges, they don't have courts that serve justice anyway. You see, like, look at the politics, please. This is not a matter of justice for anybody. I mean, I don't want to appear to be politically charged here, but this is the truth. This is what it is. And therefore, you're talking about lack of justice for men and women. So when they read a verse that talks about women witnesses and so on, they take it out of its context and out of every context, and then they make women not allowed to be judges or member of parliament, or they don't have parliaments anyway, and they don't want that because they have monopoly of power. You know, the Pharaoh divided the people in order to rule them. إِنَّ فِرْعَوْنَ عَلَى فِي الْأَرْضِ وَجَعَلَ أَهْلَهَا شِيَعًا يَسْتَضْعِفُ طَائِفَةً مِنْهُ. So the policy in the countries of tyranny is divide and conquer. And therefore, the divisions, part of it has to do with the suppression of women. And I'm not just saying that, I know that this is the case. And I know, I lived there not long enough to know that every time a different administration comes or a different minister or whatever that has to do with women issues, it depends on how weak the government is. They start to be very hard on women. Amongst other things, because there is a very fragile system at stake. That is one of the main challenges for any renewal in Islamic fiqh today. The issues of women are the real test for an authentic renewal that does not compromise Islam or the fixed parts of Islam, the immutable parts, and also does not sell out to traditions that are un-Islamic or to either Western traditions that are un-Islamic. So you don't sell out to any un-Islamic thing, and you also have a balanced way of renewal and revision. If you are referring to Hadith Umm Humayd, the woman who came to Prophet and told him that I would like to pray in your mosque and my husband is not allowing me. And he told her, Salatiki fi baytiki khayru min salatiki fi masjidi. Your prayers at home is better than your prayers in my mosque. This is a hadith that has a munasaba, that has a particular reason. Because Umm Humayd had children and she lived far. If you go, if you take only al-Bukhari and Muslim's narrations, there is the short version of the hadith. But I looked for the hadith in a book, one of the books I wrote outside, Al-Mar'atu fil Masjid, you know, women in the mosque. I looked for the different narrations of hadith, and the narrations I cited there are Hassan and above, right? Umm Humayd came from far to the mosque and came to the mosque of the Prophet. Well, Abu Humayd did not like that because she walked 5 times a day to the mosque. So the Prophet was reconciling between Umm Humayd and Abu Humayd. So he told her, your prayers at home is better than your prayers here. This is not for every place and time. Tayyib. There are many other ahadith that are against that meaning. How do we reconcile? Some scholars talked about an-naskh or abrogation, that it was okay for women to pray in the mosque, and then after hadith Umm Humayd, this was mansukh, you know, this was abrogated and cancelled. And I think that this is wrong. You could differ with me. I think that there is no abrogation here. Because abrogation has to have an evidence, a dalil. You cannot just abrogate with your mind. And you cannot abrogate a century after the Prophet ﷺ. I mean, this is something that was well known in Medina. Imam Malik talked about women in the Prophet's mosque, etc. And there are hundreds of verses of hadith about women being in the mosque of the Prophet ﷺ. And therefore the hadith is taken out of its context. That this is when the woman has a family or she's compromising something at home and so forth by walking to the mosque, etc. Then yes, her prayers at home is better than her prayers in the mosque. Otherwise, her prayers in the mosque is better. And this is evidenced by tons of evidences. مَا أَفْلَحَ قَوْمٌ وَلُّ أَمْرَهُمْ رَأَى. Another one of these, you know, a couple dozen landmines in the field of women in Islam. And the hadith has another context, another munasabah. They were talking about the daughter of Kisra, or like that girl who took over the throne of Kisra, of the king of Persia at the time. And the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا أَفْلَحَ قَوْمٌ وَلُّ أَمْرَهُمْ رَأَى. They will not succeed with this girl. But then he said, imra'ah, not al-mar'ah. Now we get to usul proper. Because are we going to consider that the word imra'ah is going to be for every place and time? If we're going to do that and apply that consistently, we will have a fiqh that is impossible. Like this is exactly like the scholars who said about Ayat al-Saif, the verse of the sword in Surah Al-Anfal, Al-Bara'a, Tawbah. فَإِذَا انْسَلَخَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُرُمُ فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَحْصُرُوهُمْ وَقُلُوهُمْ. So the verse is saying, after the sacred months are over, kill the disbelievers wherever you find them. And then in the tafsir, you will find that some of the mufassirin said, عمومه اللفظي يقتضي عموم الزمان والمكان. Because the language is general, therefore this is for every place and time. So kill the disbelievers in every place and time because the language عموم اللفظ. And this is not, we need a lecture on this. The issue of عموم اللفظ, the issue of taking a word and because it is general, make it a general rule. You bring a حكم عام من لفظ عام. So you take a word that is general and you bring a rule that is general. That doesn't work like that. It doesn't work. Because if you apply this consistently, you'll have so many problems with our understanding, everybody's understanding of fiqh. Okay, so why did some traditions have issues with women going to a mosque and so on? This is one explanation is hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, when she said that had the Prophet seen what the women did in his mosque, he would have banned them from the mosque, as the children of Israel were banned. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ma fa'alat لَمَنَعَهُنَّ كَمَا مُنِعَتْ نِسَاءُ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. She said that because some wrong thing happened in the mosque. I think that this is extreme. But at the end, she was dealing with a particular case. When you go to a mosque today, the sister will ask, you're not going for any foul behavior. I mean, foul behavior is everywhere. You can do it. I mean, everywhere, east or west, whether you live in Calgary or worse, you live in Dubai, you go out in the street and everything is there. So why do you go to the mosque to do something wrong? Allah forbid, you see. So I'm talking about that. This is contextualized. A lot of the understandings of the traditions that are related to women and Islam is contextualized with particular times and particular problems. But people, some people had an interest in taking that and generalizing it. And especially in the political context I talked about.
Thank
you.
I had a question. Sure.
This brother
has a question. Assalamu alaikum. As Muslims living in the West and in Canada, how can we benefit from this theory of maqasid al-sharia when dealing with non-Muslims? So, like, how does the maqasid al-sharia differ from the traditional fiqh when it comes to dealing with non-Muslims?
Yeah, so how do we deal with non-Muslims when it comes to maqasid sharia? I think this is a very good question, because when you make da'wah, you need this understanding of Islam. I'm asked all the time, why non-Muslims, why don't you drink? I could say that Allah said in the Quran that innama al-khamru wal-mansir wal-ansab wal-azlam rijisum min amal shaitan, that wine is dirty, or alcohol or intoxicants, I could say, is dirty. And therefore, I don't drink. This is dirt from the works of Satan. I believe in that. This is Quran, of course. But the best way to explain it is through one of the maqasid al-sharia, which is related with the hifz al-aql, the preservation of mind. So my answer is typically, well, there is a value, one of the higher principles in Islam, and I teach this stuff, that is called the preservation of mind. Anything that takes you out of your sobriety is something that is highly sinful in Islam, because it compromises your consciousness, your awakeness. Then, of course, the question will be, well, what if you drink a drop? Would it still be wrong? And my answer is, well, the Prophet ﷺ was asked this question, what if I drink a drop? And then he told the person who asked him, and then tomorrow you drink in your thawb, he told him, or في هذه أشار إلى يعني ثوبه. So tomorrow you drink a lot. And the answer would be, well, no, I will not drink a lot. So when you get into the rational answer, you will find some philosophical mind who will debate with you, which is fine. This is very good for da'wah. Because they will tell you, well, I drink socially. I really, really drink socially. And I get this answer all the time. And then I tell him, okay, John, like, be truthful with me. Have you ever gotten drunk? The answer would be, of course. Well, a couple times. Yeah, well, that is highly sinful. And that is why it is bad. And then I take another maqasidi angle, which is, you know how much it costs the public budget to deal with all the medical bill of alcohol? Alcohol, in terms of the medical bill on this country and many other countries, is much worse than drugs, really, when it comes to the public expense. And therefore, we are destructing ourselves as a community, as Canadians or whatever. You could tell that person that we are destroying our health. Otherwise, we're very healthy people. But most of our problems come from that. So when you take a maqasidi approach, you're taking a rational, a why approach. A believer could take
إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام religious. If you see that the person who asks the question is a believer, then it's haram, أخي, خلاص يعني. But for non-Muslims, it's very important to go through the maqasid lens. When they talk about, they ask about the hijab, for example, you talk about the maqsid of the hijab, the purpose of the hijab. Has to do with chastity, has to do with protection of women, with choice, these kinds of maqasid. But then, of course, the answer will be, well, so chastity as in a woman showing her beauty, or, yes. Okay, what if she is old? Can she show her beauty? Well, the Quran says she can. And of course, it's وقاعد من النساء التي لا يرجون نكاحا فليس عليهن جناح أن يضعن ثيابهن. Of course, in our communities we do the opposite. Like the girls show their beauty and then when they become older, they start to wear hijab. It's actually the other way around. When you are older and you have gray hair, then you can start to show your hair. So that is the right understanding, but it's So then the rational debate will bring sense to Islam. Alhamdulillah, I have many experiences in this, and I get the answer, well, I'm not buying your argument, but it makes sense. And some people say, oh, I've never thought about it this way. That actually makes a lot of sense, especially for the drinking part. Many people, so it's a way of da'wah. To make da'wah is to look into the why. But then you will have to look into the wisdoms. Why do you fast? Well, I can tell them that, you know, fasting is prescribed in one of the arkan of Islam. That's not enough. But then, depends on the person. If the person is a very simple person, well, it's a religious obligation. Why? Well, it's, you know, to shed those 5 pounds that I gain every year. Oh, that's very good. I had this conversation last Ramadan in a cafe here in Ottawa with an old woman, so very simple, and she's like, so I told her, well, just to shed some of these pounds. She said, oh, I like that. How do you do it? Let me do that as well. Let me fast with you. So it's a good da'wah. And if the person is more serious and more philosophical, then you can talk about the benefits of fasting, the health benefits and the spiritual benefits and to control and to learn taqwa. The Quran said, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you achieve taqwa. What is taqwa? Is to fear Allah, to have sincerity. If the person is ready for this kind of answer, tell them this is a training for sincerity because nobody really knows whether I'm fasting or not, or I broke my fast by myself. But I am training myself to be sincere and to watch that, you know, God is watching over me, etc. So this kind of thing is very important. Maqasid al-Sharia are also, I found in multi-faith dialogues and multi-faith stuff, is a good common ground. We could differ with Christians and Jews over issues of belief. We believe, for example, that Jesus is not the Son of God. He's a man, he's a prophet. So we could differ with them over this. But we could have a common ground of working towards betterment of the community, for example, or issues of justice. And so justice is one of the maqasid of the Sharia. You read a lot about this when you read about maqasid al-Sharia. So we could say, well, we could have our theological differences, but we could cooperate on matters of justice and matters of public health and matters of elevating poverty and so forth. These kinds of things also is a good common ground amongst Muslims and non-Muslims. And mentioning that, I have to say that it's also a common ground amongst Muslims themselves. Because sometimes we deal with non-Muslims friendly, but then we deal with our fellow Muslim in a very bad way, who is, you know, just different in madhab or whatever. So it's a common ground also amongst us. When you look at the maqasid, there is no difference really between the different madahib and so on.
So the question is from the back: how do we use the concept of maqasid sharia when it comes to dealing with homosexuality in the West?
When you deal with the issue of maqasid, one of the maqasid has to do with what's called al-fitra, or mura'at al-fitra, or preserving the true nature of humans. Some people have a fitra, or an innate nature, or an inclination, that is not the normal inclination. And that abnormal inclination is not haram in itself. What is haram is to act upon it. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there were people that were called al-mukhannathun, or people with a mixed gender, kind of, like if I translate literally. And these people existed at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and you find in some hadith that, you know, they were in the mosque and they were talking to the mothers of the believers in one hadith particularly, and that guy who said the poetry, so the Prophet ﷺ said, no, he understands very well what he's talking about, do not allow him in your private room, etc., etc. There are a number of hadith, I'm saying, that prove that these people existed in the time of the Prophet ﷺ and were dealt with in normal dealing, in the usual kind, normal and average dealing of Muslims. What is haram is to act upon a desire that is not allowed in Islam. Physical desires are not allowed between any two people who are not married, whether two males, two females, or a male or a female, or male and female. But Islam allows marriage only for a male and a female, because a male and a female form a family and bring children. And there are maqasid for zawaj. There are certain purposes for people to get married, male and female. Okay, so what do these people do? Well, they have a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they are dedicated, if they are Muslim, if they are Muslim and they want to go by Islam, if they are not Muslim or they don't want to go by Islam anyway, then this kind of question doesn't apply to them. They can do whatever they want. It's not really whatever. But I'm asking if somebody is sincere, and they ask, I'm Muslim, and I get this question sometimes, what do I do? I say, well, this is a test from Allah. But in Islam, what is halal is very clear, and what is haram is very clear. And it is haram to express these desires in a physical way. You feel certain things, if they are natural, you cannot do anything about them. Or if they are not, then perhaps you can deal. If this came after trauma or some, there are sometimes reasons that are psychological and sometimes natural. We also have to be a bit sophisticated when we deal with this question. It's a tough question. It's not a simple question. But then when we deal with that question, we have to be clear that even if it becomes legal in a certain country, it will continue to be haram. So when the a few lawyers really sat in the United States and changed the definition of marriage, this is a huge lobbying case to me, because like, are you serious? You're changing the definition of marriage in the United States, and you don't have a public opinion that is measured or that is whatever. Some media is just saying that 60% of the Americans are okay with that. That doesn't go with democracy, like proper democracy, because you are changing something very deep in the society, and the definition of marriage comes from religion anyway in the United States. So, but even if this passes scrutiny and the lobbying was strong enough to make those guys sitting in the Supreme Court change the definition of marriage in the country, doesn't make it legal, and will never make it legal. And we as Muslims should not accept that as Islamic. Yet, we should be kind to people who are sinners, whether they are sinners drinking alcohol or committing adultery or committing an act of zina in terms of homosexuality. We have to be kind, and we have to accept that people have faults. And we cannot discriminate in the sense of violence or in the sense of, like, this is not Islamic. It's not really allowed. Yes, it's wrong. But we should not discriminate against a person who is a sinner. We should advise, yes, if they are Muslim and they hear our advice. So very few thoughts, but it's a long story.
Has the purpose of specific legal injunctions, like the Hadith of Rajam, the verse of Surah An-Nur, the ayat of cutting the hand of the thief, and how do you reconcile those with the maqasid, and how do you determine the objective, the scope, and the operational limits of the maqasid?
You lumped a number of hudud that are not the same. You mentioned the rajm or stoning. I do believe that a rajm is from the Torah, not from the Quran. And I do believe that the Rajm was abrogated, was nusakh, mansukh, by the verse of An-Nur. If you refer to Al-Bukhari in the hadith of Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, and he was asked, أَكَانَ الرَّجْمُ قَبْلَ النُّورِ أَمْ بَعْدَهَا قَالَ لَا أَدْرِي. Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, one of the companions, as Bukhari narrated, narrated a discussion between the companions. Was the stoning before the verses that talked about lashing the adulterers or not, or was it after? And he said, I don't know. There was a debate, and it's a longer story, but we can talk about it. So I wrote about it in one of my books, in Arabic though, on the stoning being the application of the Torah until Surah An-Nur has changed it. And the evidence is that in Surah An-Nisa, there is another verse that talks about the punishment for adulteresses. فَإِذَا أُحْصِنَّ فَعَلَيْهِنَّ نِصْفُ مَا عَلَى الْمُحْصَنَاتِ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ. It's talking about the slaves at that time and saying that if they commit adultery, then they have a punishment that is half of the punishment of the adulteresses, the married, the muhsanat, ma'ala al-muhsanat. Al-ihsan is a long story as well, but let's talk about al-muhsanat as married adulteresses. So how can the Quran talk about half of stoning? And that doesn't make any sense. And then when you read the hadith that talked about al-shaykh wa al-shaykhatu إِذَا زَنَيَا فَرْجُمُهُمَا الْبَتَّةِ, that there was a verse in the Quran, and then the verse was, the Prophet was made to forget the verse, and then some, I guess, chicken or something came and ate the piece of leather that the verse was written on. That doesn't make any sense. That hadith has a problem with what's called the matn, or the content, the logic, the coherence. Not anybody who says anything becomes a hadith. It has to be coherent talk. So you're really telling me that some chicken came and ate a piece of leather, and therefore a verse was removed from the Quran? Like, are you serious? You know, so it's a longer story. But basically, if you're talking about stoning, this is something that was abrogated by Islam. If you're talking about the other hudud, you have to know that there are six hudud that are mentioned: sariq wa sariqatu, zaniyat wa zani, and so forth. And the other punishments. Can you look at them as means to an end? The answer is it's somewhere in between looking at them as means to an end and looking them at as ends in their own right, in the sense that I believe they are maximum punishments rather than everyday punishments. I don't think they are savage or whatever or cruel. I don't. They are in the Quran. These are hadith. This is Sharia. But how can you apply them is a very different question. I see them as maximum punishments, so they don't apply in every case. And I see them as applying first to the people who have more crime than others. So before you cut the hand of a driver who stole a wallet or a ring from his whatever princess, whatever, driving her around in one of those countries, you should start by cutting the hands of these princes who are involved in major theft. And sometimes court decides that they are involved in theft of millions of dollars. So what I am saying is you cannot apply them to the weak and not the rich. And this is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ أَنَّهُمْ كَانُوا إِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمُ الشَّرِيفُ تَرَكُوهُ وَإِذَا سَرَقَ فِيهِمُ الضَّعِيفُ أَقَامُ عَلَيْهِ الْحَدِ. The people before you were destroyed when they applied the hudud on the poor and not on the rich and the sharif and the nobleman. So when you start to apply them by cutting the hands of these princes who stole the money of the Ummah, and all of these presidents who are killing people everywhere in the name of the whatever, Siyadat al-Dawla or sovereignty and all of this, like, and non-excuses, then I can start to talk about the hudud. I hope this answers the question. It's a long story, but I think in applying them in a modern state, they require also some research in terms of policy. Because if you cut somebody's hand today, if you think that this is fair, a person who is disabled, that he's going to be disabled, he is the responsibility of the government. Like, now collectively, in a nation state, in a modern state, we have to take care of that person. We have to see how can that person live, because we don't live in the old times anymore. The old politics is that people manage their own things. But today, that person will have to be helped by the society in order to live. How can the person live? Well, some scholars in Saudi Arabia gave a fatwa that the person would have an artificial hand, artificial limb. And it happens over there, I know that. But what is the point, really, of cutting the hand and then putting a robot instead of my brother is laughing. That becomes a problem. It's problematic. It is a fatwa. I know it. And they are trying to grapple with the situation. Why? Because it's not fiqh anymore. It is fiqh siyasa sharia. This is something that you apply really seriously in a government. It's not just reading the Quran anymore. So what I'm saying is, when you take the verse and put it in a government institution, that becomes something that will raise questions that you have to answer. Questions of justice, these are very important, and questions of policy, because you have to answer these questions, and the answer cannot be, silly. You have to have a proper answer.
I'll take one last question, inshallah, and we'll close.
My comment is about what we talked about the sisters and the sisters coming forward to be leaders. But I just want to point out, we've probably seen on the media and in newspapers pictures of women leading the salah and then men praying behind them. So sometimes the Western world leads us to this kind of ignorance. Can you shed some light on that?
Well, I don't think that a woman could lead the salah in the masjid. I do think that she can lead the salah in her family. And that is the implication of Hadith Umm Waraqah. There is a companion, Umm Waraqah, Sahabiya. She asked the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the Hadith, to me, is Sahih. I followed the narration. I wrote a paper about it. And in a few other collections, anyway. And they differed, I have to get into a technical detail, they differed over Abdurrahman ibn Khallad, that narrator, and whether he's authentic or not. If you follow the chain of the narrators, or if a scholar follows the chain, they will see that the chain is authentic. And the hadith that they considered contradictory to this hadith of Umm Waraqah leading her household, including her muezzin and her slave and so forth, the hadith that contradicted that is hadith Ali radiallahu anhu, la ta'ummu al-mar'ah. But that hadith is daif in every collection, is not authentic in every collection. And hadith was Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, akhiruhunna min haith akharahunna Allah. That's also daif. So if you look at the hadith without any bias, you will see that the hadith is sahih. I conclude from the hadith, and I wrote that in that particular book, that a woman could lead her household, or if her husband doesn't read the Quran. I had a question, and I answered in the European Council, not in the capacity of the European Council, but when I was there, yeah. From a convert, they didn't issue a fatwa on this particular one, they didn't publish it. So it's about a sister saying that she married a convert and he doesn't read the Quran and she memorizes the Quran. Can she lead him in the prayers? I said yes, but not in the mosque. Because I think the mosque has a structure that did not change at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, and I don't see a benefit in changing that. A woman could give a lesson in the mosque if she wishes. Aisha narrated hadith and so on, and many of every scholar of Islam had female mashaykh. Who narrated the hadith, she can give a lesson, she gave a lecture. But I don't think that leading the prayer in the mosque is right. But it's a particular case in the household if the circumstances allow. But now women are, there is a new fad where women have all women mosque. They go and do adhan and iqama and so forth, and they give khutbah for Jum'ah. And there is a mosque now in California and a few other places. I find this wrong because this divides our community. This, the mosque is not supposed to be like that. The sisters have a grievance, which is we don't have a place in the mosque. So that's why we went and made a women mosque. And I think it's fair enough, but the solution is not to make a women mosque. The solution is to bring women back to the mosque and empower them and give them their place as they had the place in the mosque of the Prophet. It was a woman who built the minbar, and it was a woman, Fakiha bint Ubayd, it was Umm Mihjam who maintained the mosque, it was Rufayda who had this ambulance tent in the mosque. It was like all of the women of female companions, they did many things in the mosque of the Prophet. So we have to bring them back to the mosque. But the sisters, again, if they pray Dhuhr, if they do Adhan and Iqama and pray Dhuhr, and that's what I told them when I was asked about that on social media. I told them, well, if you do Adhan and Iqama and pray Dhuhr, then it's correct. There is nothing wrong in a woman doing Adhan and Iqama and praying Dhuhr and giving a lecture. But that kind of hila divides our community. I don't think it's right for the community. I think we, as communities, will have to have men and women in our mosques. When a non-Muslim comes in the mosque, they have to find females to talk to if she's a woman. I had a number of complaints, really, from Canadian neighbors here. I went to the mosque, I was asking about Islam. I only find men. You don't allow women to the mosque? And I tell her, no, there are sisters in the mosque, just ask, etc. I think it's right, it's wrong that we don't have women who represent Islam in the mosque, in some of our mosques. I lived in London, UK, and most of the mosques there don't have a place for women. It's just brothers only kind of sign. In London, UK, and the BBC4 made a documentary. It was a scandal back in 2007. They made a documentary about it. Some BBC anchor wore a hijab and tried to knock on the mosques. Can I pray here? And they say, no, go. This kind of thing. So it's a scandal. We have to give women the place in the mosque. I don't think they should lead the prayers, but they should have their place. And they should participate in knowledge as well. They should give lessons. They should. If we have a woman scholar, why doesn't she give us a dars? Why not? It happened in our history. Jazakallah khair.
Jazakallah khair. Thank you very much. You know, I asked one of my teachers, how do you know a speaker is a good speaker? And he told me if he leaves you after he's done more thirsty for knowledge, that's a good speaker. So I'm pretty sure that we have more questions in our minds, and that's the purpose of today's lecture.
كثير الجود محمل وإن بقاءه خصب ونعم.